Welcome to worship on this Thursday of Holy Week. It's a privilege for us to be worshiping together as sister congregations, Trinity and Arvada Presbyterian Church. We began Lent together, and now we're finishing Lent together. Matthew, Mark, and Luke think of this night, Thursday of Holy Week, as the night in which Jesus gave us the gift of communion, a way to fellowship with him, even while we're still in this world. But when John recalls Thursday night of Holy Week, he reminds us of a way in which Jesus demonstrated his love for his disciples by washing their feet. That's the focus of our service tonight, this intentional demonstration of Jesus' love for the disciples and for us. Let's worship God together.
Listen, sing along, or meditate as Chelsea Moon and the Franz Brothers bring us What Wondrous Love Is This. Thank you.
sing His love for me, and through eternity I'll sing on, and through eternity I'll sing on.
Do you remember your Last Supper before the pandemic? The last meal you had out at a restaurant with friends? If you had known it was your last, would you have lingered? Would you have ordered dessert? Would you have held your friend's hand and told them how much you loved them? If you had known, would you have washed their feet? Tonight we gather together because this night was the beginning of the end. This night was Jesus' Last Supper with His disciples. Take a moment to imagine how Jesus must have felt. Friends, with all of this in mind, I invite you to join me in our call to worship. Tonight, we will hear again and again of a love that knows no bounds. May we be fully present here. May we worship God. Friends, let us pray. Holy God, again and again, we are caught in the tension of light and shadow, death and resurrection. You spoke the world into being. You illumined the universe by your very speech, and then filled the void with life. Indeed, you have filled the void of darkness and death and the empty promises of the abyss with new life and new creation. And so again and again, we look to you in the space between the world and the kingdom, longing for the fulfillment of your word in the holy work of the Holy Spirit, and the reign of Christ and our Creator King. Let the people of God say, Amen.
Oh, sacred head, now wounded with grief and shame, weighed down, now scornfully surrounded with thorns, thy only crown. Oh, sacred head, what glory, what bliss till now was thine. Yet though despised and gored, favor. joy can ne'er be spoken. Above all joys beside, when in thy body broken, I thus with safety hide.
Friends, this service, it's not Sunday. Isn't that interesting? Today is a special service and an opportunity to finish up our Lent. Yeah, Lent is finally coming to a close. It's taken so long. And with Lent coming to an end, we see the last week and the last moments of Jesus' life on this place. And sometimes that can feel sad, or maybe we get frustrated at the characters in those stories, or maybe we feel guilty that maybe I could have said something like that to Jesus. We have all these big feelings, but the good thing to know is that you're not alone in feeling that. Some grandparents have gone through this story for many, many years and still have those similar feelings. Or maybe there's a friend who is encountering the story for the first time and it's very confusing. The point is that we're not alone in encountering this story and this walk with Jesus. We have a whole community of people. And now you're starting to wonder, Miss Abby, why is this behind you? Well, this has been the symbol that the big kids in church have been using. It's another symbol for and. Yes and no. This symbol helped our older adults being able to understand Lent this year. And now we have an opportunity to join with our whole community in creating an artwork together of knowing that even if we did Sunday school at different times, or we did church services at different times, we are still one big community coming together to love and serve Jesus. So, tomorrow on Good Friday, from 1 to 5 p.m., come by Trinity. Come by Trinity and grab a ribbon. And on the ribbon, we're going to start writing some reflections or a prayer that you think is very purposeful to you this year, and being able to add it my one ribbon on there looks a little sad. It needs some friends. It's hard to see our community right now as a big picture because we're so spread out. Hopefully with doing this, we can be able to see the great color and patchwork of our community, of ages and stages of life that sometimes we don't get to see right now. Well, friends, before we continue with our service, let's end this time here with a prayer, shall we? Now, we like to shake it out so that we can be able to get all the wiggles out of being able to talk to God. Ready? And we'll bring our hands together, back together in 3, 2, 1. Dear Jesus, we have lots of emotions right now. We pray that you might be the guiding light in this opportunity to reflect on your life, how you lived it, and even more powerfully, of how you suffered through it. Help us to see your work in this world, in this place. In your name we pray. Amen.
Now hear how John describes this night of love and affection. From John 13, beginning at verse 1. Now before the festival of the Passover, Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart from this world and to go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The devil had already put it into the heart of Judas, son of Simon Iscariot, to betray Jesus. And during supper, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going to God, got up from the table, took off his outer robe, and tied a towel around himself. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel that was tied around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus answered, "You do not know what I'm doing, but later you'll understand." Peter said to him, "You will never wash my feet." And Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no share with me." Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head." But Jesus said to him, "One who has bathed does not need to wash except for the feet, but is entirely clean. And you are clean, though not all of you." For Jesus knew who was to betray him. And for that reason, he said, "Not all of you are clean." Thanks be to God for the reading of his word. Amen.
Friends, the closer and closer we get to the crucifixion, the more earnest our prayers of confession feel. For we know what was done to Jesus, betrayal, humiliation, violence, and death, are things we, humanity, did to Jesus and still do to one another. So with all earnestness, a sense of urgency, and a deep hope for transformation, we return this prayer once again, trusting that the God who holds the stars in the sky is holding us tonight. Let us confess together. Holy God, who holds us together, if I were to place myself at your table, I would probably be Peter, misunderstanding your radical hospitality, sticking to the rules, arguing what I do and don't deserve. Then again, it is possible that I'd be Judas, the one who betrayed you, the one who failed to see the good and right in front of him, the one who might have thought he wasn't worthy of your love. If I were to place myself at your table, it's possible I would be the one of the unnamed disciples, watching but not speaking, silently missing the opportunity to tell you what I believe and how much I love you. If I were to place myself at your table, I'm confident that I would have made the same mistakes your well-intentioned disciples made. There is no surprise there. What is surprising is that I know you would have washed my feet nonetheless. So forgive me, God. Wash not just my feet, but my hands and my head also. Amen. Family of faith, Jesus knew that Peter would deny. He knew that Judas would betray. And he knew the disciples would hide in fear. And still, and still, and still, he invited them. He washed their feet and he fed them. Friends, we worship the living Christ, so no matter who we are, no matter where we go, no matter how great our mistakes or regrets in life, we will always be invited and held together by the living God. Again and again and again and again and again, we are forgiven. and again and again and again and again and again. We are held. Let the people of God say, Amen.
Say goodbye to someone you love, someone you know you won't see for a long time, someone for whom you know there are rough days ahead of them. How do you say goodbye, and how do you let go of one another when it's time to go? How do you take those first steps that lead you away, and how do you override your heart that begs you to stay? I think we all know what it's like to say goodbye when we don't want to, when we don't want to be parted. I experienced that when I dropped off my daughters for their first day at college. It was so hard to say goodbye when I knew I wouldn't see them again until Christmas. It was hard to say goodbye when I didn't know if they'd get along with their roommate or if they'd make friends, or if they'd be able to keep up with their schoolwork. It was hard to say goodbye when I knew I wouldn't be able to be present if trouble came along for them. So it was a long and lonely drive back home. The question of how do you say goodbye is about how do you let the other know just how much you love them, so that how you say goodbye will sustain them while you're gone. The words we choose, the reminders we leave behind, will be all they have to hold on to once we're gone. And we seldom feel like words are enough or are adequate to express how much we love them. And so that lack of proper words, meaningful words, makes our parting all the more painful. When Jesus was saying goodbye to his small band of disciples, he found a way to express his love that didn't require words. And while the memory of precise words said when leaving might fade over time, what Jesus did to demonstrate his love would never be forgotten. Jesus's time to depart was at hand. It was time for him to return to the Father. And his leaving would not be on a jet plane. His mode of travel would be through his crucifixion and death. And Jesus was a whole lot more clear about his leave-taking than the disciples were. So Jesus is looking for a way to say goodbye and to express his love that would sustain them once the trauma of his arrest his interrogation and his execution hit them full on. And Jesus is preparing them now for something they could not imagine. And he wants them to realize that nothing that is about to happen is random or unexpected by Jesus, but rather all of it was for them. All of it was for us. All of it was for the world that the Father and Jesus and the Holy Spirit love. So how does Jesus say goodbye when it pains him to leave them? When he knows it'll be far too long before they're back together? When he knows that there'll be tornadoes of tragedy tossing them about? When he wants them to know how profoundly he loves them? Watch. Watch what he does. John tells us that Jesus got up from the table in the middle of the meal to show them his love. That's the first thing he did. He got up from the table. Picture one of those gatherings with family and friends around a dinner table when you are so glad that all of you are together. You're feeling so glad to be with them that your heart feels full, so full it begins to hurt or even ache with joy and gladness that you're together, and with a desire to make it last. Because you know all too soon, everyone will get up and go their separate ways. I picture Jesus feeling that, looking around the table at these 12 men with whom he has spent the last 3 years. They've known hunger and hostility together. They've shared the uncertainty of where they would spend the next night. They ministered together from sunrise to late in the evening, experiencing the power of God flowing through them. Jesus had taught them, chided them, nudged them, poured himself into them as much as they could receive, as much as they could welcome. And now it's time's up. Now it's time to say goodbye. Ready or not, Jesus has to leave them. I picture Jesus registering all of this as the disciples are carrying on a conversation, bantering, laughter between them. I picture Jesus then deciding how he will show them the full extent of his love. Jesus got up from the table, took off his outer robe, wrapped a towel around his waist, poured water into a basin. And then began to wash the disciples' feet and to dry them with a towel that was around his waist. Notice the precision with which John recounts this act. Every step is documented. Even though it's been decades since this took place, and John is writing it, it apparently was etched into the memories of his disciples. What did Jesus do? He, their Lord and Master, stooped to serve them in love, demonstrating in tender actions just how dear they were to him. Somehow this way of saying goodbye would sum up and hold together all that they've experienced over the last 3 years. This memory would be what they would recall, what they would cling to, what they would remember when the ache of Jesus' absence was too much to bear. They would remember seeing Jesus' head bent over their feet as he cupped his hand in the water and scooped it over their trail-worn feet. It's these thoughtful actions, these surprises, that show us how much we are loved that mean so much to us. We know this from our own life experiences. When Cynthia and I were getting married, she wanted to buy me cufflinks to wear on our wedding day. And she had promised to get them to me, but as the wedding day came around, she had not given me cufflinks, so I kind of sadly pulled a pair out of my drawer, feeling sad that she had somehow forgotten that, and went to meet her at her home where our wedding ceremony took place. When I got there, one of our son-in-laws came and brought to me cufflinks that she had made. She had been trying to get Canadian pennies stamped with 2017 to commemorate our wedding date. Pennies to match the rose gold wedding bands we'd wear from Canada because we were gonna honeymoon in Quebec. She tried for weeks before somebody finally told her they don't make pennies in Canada anymore. So someone sent her nickels and they arrived just the day before the wedding, and I was so touched at this thoughtful and hard work to demonstrate her love for me. Our daughter, Mary Claire, celebrated her husband Matt's 30th birthday just a couple of weeks ago. Matt has a very distinctive look. He is tall, he has round glasses, he always wears a beanie, a knit cap on his head, and he started sporting a mustache during COVID. For his birthday, she surprised him by taking him around to different friends' houses and experiencing his birthday together in small, socially distanced groups. But she made a hoodie sweatshirt with a picture of Matt on it and sent it to all of the friends that they were gonna visit. So they greeted him at the door wearing these hoodie sweatshirts. And as you look at this image of the sweatshirt, it kind of looks like Matt. Very symbolic of Matt. When you see it all together, it's a perfect fit. He felt so loved by those actions. Somehow, this washing the disciples' feet demonstrated just how much Jesus loved them, but also interpreted everything that was about to happen after this meal. Because as soon as Jesus sat back down at the table, Judas got up to leave the table to go and betray Jesus. As soon as that meal was over, Jesus would be arrested. The disciples, these same disciples whose feet he had just washed, would use those feet to run for their lives. They would see his arrest. They would see his mistreatment by the chief priest's servants and by the Roman soldiers. They would hear of his agony as his broken body hung from the cross until there was no breath left in it. And what Jesus had just done was preparing them for that. Because all of that that was about to happen would also be a parable of love, showing us just how much Jesus loved us too. But it was this washing of their feet, the symbol of making them clean, that would help them understand that trauma later on. Having loved his own, Jesus loved them to the very end. All throughout the Gospel of John, Jesus has been referring to this saving act of love he is going to do as, when I'm raised up, all who look to me will be saved. That's how Jesus has been describing the way in which he's going to love the world to the very end. When I am raised up, all who look to me will see and be saved. I've been picturing all during Lent this raising up of Jesus, high enough for all the world to see and be saved. That image has been in my mind all during Lent. I picture the cross of Jesus laying flat on the ground. I imagine the Roman soldiers leading Jesus to him, to it, and insisting that he lay on that cross. I've tried not to imagine how they secured his body to the cross with nails through his hands and his feet. But what I've been picturing is that moment when the soldiers tied ropes to the top of the cross and began to heave to lift it upright as someone at the foot of the cross guided it into the hole prepared for it, and the thud of when that cross fell into place and the pain on Jesus' face as the nails bore the full weight of his body for the first time. Jesus being raised for all the world to see so that those who look on him could be saved. For the 12 disciples, Jesus said goodbye by tenderly washing their feet, letting them know how much they were loved. For the rest of the world, Jesus said goodbye in a way that assured us that he loved us too, by moving from that dinner table to his cross so that he could be raised up in an act of love for all the world to see and by which they could be saved. How do you say goodbye to someone you love? Someone you know for whom it would be far too long you see one another? How do you say goodbye to someone you know there's a lot of trouble ahead for them? You say goodbye in a way that reassures them that you'll be able to say hello again. That's what we really want when we say goodbye, to be reassured that we'll see each other again. Jesus said goodbye to us in a way that reassured us we're loved and we will see him again by his being raised on the cross. Let's pray together. Lord, we are grateful for this tender action because far too often we wonder if we are loved. It's hard to picture you loving people like us. And so when we see you doing this surprise and tender action to the disciples, it helps us to picture you doing the same thing to us because we knew that they were no more worthy of your love than we are. So this Maundy Thursday, we let you love us as you cleanse us and make us whole, as you let us have a part of your life in your kingdom and your eternity. We rest in that love. We embrace the gift of it and the chance to say hello again to you in the future. It's in your name we pray with very grateful hearts. Amen.
Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Were you there when they Were you there when they laid him in the tomb? Oh. Sometimes it causes me to
invite you, of all ages, to practice silence after the benediction. Many generations before us have left this service in silence to honor Jesus' death and to reflect. Ooh, we aren't used to silence, are we? So I wonder, what will you notice while being silent from now until the morning? Hear these words today. As you leave this space, may your mouth speak of God's goodness. May your arms hold those in need. May your feet walk towards justice. May your heart trust its worth. May your soul dance in God's grace. And may this be your rhythm again and again and again until God's promised day. In the name of the lover, the beloved, and love itself, go with courage, go with heart, go in peace. Amen.